باش هنبوز
وبكرة عليك في الكاس مندوز.
First there was the day of rage, then the 1 million Egyptian march, and today is the day of departure or farewell, where Egyptians say farewell to their president of 30 years, President Hosni Mubarak.
That's Ben Wiedemann reporting earlier today. Our friend and former colleague Christian Amanpour is also here reporting in Cairo for ABC News, doing the remarkable work that she always does. She has had interviews, off-camera interviews with President Hosni Mubarak, as well as an on-camera interview in English with the Vice President, Omar Suleiman. I talked to Christian a short time ago.
You spent about 30 minutes with President Mubarak. Yeah. You also interviewed the Vice President, Suleiman. What did you make of them both?
Well, look, I've never met Vice President Suleiman. He's very well known to the West, he's well known to Israel, he has the Israel file, but he has never given an interview, particularly never given one to a foreign journalist.
He ran the intelligence service here.
Yes, he did, and he wanted to speak Arabic. I persuaded him to speak English, and he's obviously a very competent person, and he's somebody who has the trust of all these other officials around the world who he's dealt with. And I think they're putting their faith in him being a transitional figure and getting through this moment until their new elections.
But you talk to a lot of protesters, anti-Mubarak protesters, and they'll say, wait a minute, is the guy who's basically been the right-hand man of Hosni Mubarak, who has been running his secret intelligence, is that really the man to transition to
democracy? Well, a lot of people don't like it whatsoever, as we've both found out. But he's not personally tainted with corruption, according to all the stories about him. And from what I've been told, and this is really critical, the constitution here, the one that doesn't allow any political parties and only allows one candidate, can only be amended, I've been told, as long as the president remains in office. If he leaves, then the Speaker of the House becomes president and have to have elections in 60 days under the current constitution, which allows no more political parties. So they have to have Mubarak if they're going to amend the constitution.
And how was President Mubarak? I mean, how did he seem to
look? It was extraordinary. I've been to the palace before. I've interviewed him before in different times. And when I went to the palace to interview the vice president, I basically said, is the president here? I was really very, very pleased because it was a real sort of human moment. And with no cameras, as you know, you get a different sense from people. You get a different relationship with people. They talk to you in a different way. They don't have their game face on. And I felt like I sort of got to the heart of the embattled protagonist in this unfolding drama.
Do you think he will be willing to give up in the coming days?
I don't think in the coming days he'll do that willingly. Now, I'm not saying he won't be pushed out, but I don't think he wants to do it willingly, because I do believe he sees himself as a patriot. He's a military man who does not see deserting as something honorable, which is how he would see it. He does not want to be President Ben Ali of Tunisia, who was run out to Saudi Arabia. He said that he will not leave
this
country.
Right, he told you he wants to die on Egyptian soil.
Yes, and also he doesn't want to be humiliated and have Egypt humiliated. This, remember, is the cornerstone of the Arab world.
Interesting that we heard from Mohammed al-Baradei in the last 24 hours saying, we're not looking to humiliate members of the former regime, perhaps sending a message.
That is an important message, and perhaps there's a struggle right now on how to do it in the most dignified fashion. But clearly, the West, even President Obama, while saying we want this transition to be rapid, look, they are really afraid of what will come next if there's a vacuum, because there is no obvious. So what they're really insisting on right now, the United States, read behind the lines, is an immediate process of getting the opposition parties together and forming some kind of roadmap to go forward. That's what they really want Suleiman to do right now.
Bottom line, today we saw the Egyptian military step in a way we haven't seen for the last 48 hours. But you could look at it in the reverse and as testament to the fact that they could have stepped in 48 hours ago and prevented, I mean, with some concertina wire and a few more troops, prevented this bloodshed that we have seen. The fact that they didn't, how do you read that?
I've been asking about that, and people have said, look, this is a military who's been forced to take on a police role. In any country, that is a very tough thing for a military to do. In order not to have blood on their hands, I've been told they were trying to be neutral observers and trying to do their best to maintain law and order, loved by the population as they are. And in the square, as you've seen and I have, their chance of The army and the people are one.
But
it was clear, as you point out, that the bloodshed has forced a change, switched from neutral gear to getting in between and forcing them apart and creating a bigger buffer zone without taking sides.
They search anti-Mubarak supporters, and they've done that for days. They didn't search pro-Mubarak supporters when they arrived 48 hours ago with weapons, and they allowed them to get right up there. I find that troubling that they didn't bother to search the pro-Mubarak side, and I see that as significant. But
it is.
Yeah.
I mean, I didn't see that, but it is significant.
Yeah.
And this has been something that even officials, Egyptian officials I've spoken to, that mayhem over the last 40 hours is the mayhem over the last 48 hours is something that has reflected very badly on Egypt, and they know that.
Oh, there's nobody like you have in the field. It's good to have you out here.
It's good to be back.
All right.
A fascinating conversation there. When we come back, we'll get back to Anderson Cooper in Cairo, his reporter's notebook on this fascinating day in the Egyptian political crisis.